Hey, glad to be here on this evening. Thank you all for being here. I hope that you have been blessed through this fall series. I've been encouraged just looking through the different topics and subjects that have been shared. And so I'm looking forward to what I'm going to share with you on tonight. I want to echo those same sentiments of Brother Thomas that we appreciate your partnership in working together on the Back to School giveaway. It is a tremendous outreach and effort. This past year, we gathered over 2,500 backpacks along with school supplies. And so we served that many people, not just on that day, but then the schools afterwards, we were able to put those resources in their hands, as well as over $20,000 in gift cards, both to Target and Walmart and Shoe Carnival. And so the church was a tremendous blessing to the city of Columbia and as well as Hickman County. And so we appreciate that. I do want you all to pray, as Brother Thomas said, that we try to stay engaged in the community, because I believe that's our call, and that is what God has asked us to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Pray for us. Last year, we did this for the very first time. It's called There Is Room in the Inn. It's a homeless outreach. We put 30 homeless families up in a hotel over December 24th through the 26th. We fed them every day. We got gifts to the kids. We gave them coats and clothes and all this stuff, and so we're going to do that again this year. And so pray with and for us. And if you're not doing anything during Christmas and you want to volunteer and drop off some food or just be a blessing to those who are less fortunate, we invite you to be with us. That's December 24th through the 26th. And so just keep that in mind. But most importantly, I say that most importantly for you to pray for us. One of the blessings from that outreach is that two of the families we were able to help to move into permanent housing. And so they went from homelessness to permanent housing. So we give God the glory for that and are grateful and thankful. This fall series, Let Them Be One, and this teaching on unity, I pray that it's blessed you. But if you're like me, as I was walking through and preparing for the lesson, I think it probably has challenged all of us. Challenged us to really look at our own lives and us as church families and the family of God to say to ourselves that, are we operating in unity? Really, I say that, and as I was thinking about the measure of unity, immediately my mind went to, how do you measure the success and effectiveness of unity? How do you do that? And I say this often, is that you cannot measure success based off a horizontal relationship. What I mean by that is I can't measure success based off what you do or based off what somebody else does. My measure of success always has to be with my vertical relationship between me and God. And so that is where I believe that we find our success, because in fact, if we measure vertically, we have a long way to go as it relates to unity. And that's where we'll find ourselves, that if we continue to look towards God, because if you look at John 17, it details an intimate relationship between Christ and his Father, which is steeped in unity. It's a beautiful passage of scripture. It is powerful. And if you look at that, you say to yourself that I've got a long way to go. We got a long way to go as churches, as families of God. We got a long way to go as it relates to unity. But I believe that we can get there with God's help. I'm not sure if I can give you all the solutions on this evening as it relates to our disunity issues. But my assignment is to shed some light on what I believe that we can do to be more unified as believers. So that's my assignment. That's what I'm going to try to do in our time together. Brother Thomas already read it, but I want to read it one more time. John 17, verses 20 and verse number 21. So if you have your Bibles, your iPads, your phones, if you want to look at that, let's read together. The Bible says, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. One measure of unity. One measure of unity. I said it earlier. How do you measure unity? How can you say with surety that we as a body of believers at Southgate or at Carmack are walking in unity as a local body according to God's will. How do we know that? I'm not speaking in an abstract term. I'm saying specifically, what can we cite to say that we're walking in unity? What can we share with others to say that we are in unity? What is it that we demonstrate that shows that we understand what John 17 unity looks like? That's the question on this evening. But here's where I see the challenge. I see the challenge because God's measurement system is different from ours. So when it is that you look at your own measuring system, we look at charts and graphs and comparables. But God, in fact, says that if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, that you can move mountains. See, that's a different system of measurement than sometimes what we would say. We say, if I'm going to move the mountain, I've got to have something huge. I got to have something big. I got to have something powerful. But God says, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed. So he's reminding us in that scripture that effectiveness has more to do with faith in him than our own ability and power. So if it is that we are going to be unified, if it is we're going to walk in unity, it has more to do with faith in God. December 2019, I visited Jerusalem and the surrounding areas. We spent time in Nazareth and Bethlehem in Jordan, just all around that region for 10 days. And I was trying to think of a gift that I could bring back to the entire church. How can I really bless the church? How can they be a part of this visit? Not just with pictures, but something tangible that I could give them. As we were visiting a spice market in the old city, I walked upon a container of mustard seeds. I said, that's it right there. That's it. That's the way that I can give something to the entire church. Here it is, teenagers, that this is about 30 mustard seeds right here. And so I was able to give 5 or 6 to everybody in the entire church, and I still got a whole container full of mustard seeds. But it allowed, when I picked this mustard seed up, it allowed the scripture to come alive and see the point that Jesus is clearly making. In order to achieve God's goals, you got to have a small measure of faith. That if it is that I'm going to achieve the goals that God has before me, if we're going to be unified, it just simply takes faith in God and him moving in and among us. But here's what John 17 is teaching us before I dig into the specific scriptures that I've been assigned on tonight. Here's the first thing I want us to understand, that John 17 teaches us that there's power in prayer. That there's power in prayer. If you don't believe it, all you have to do is just get into a tight spot, just get into a circumstance that you're facing, there's no way out. And when you pray and God opens the door, you're going to know that there's power in prayer. If we're going to walk in unity, if we're going to bring others to Christ, if we're going to honor God with our unity, it will only happen with prayer as our foundation. That if I'm going to be unified, if you're going to be unified, if the body of Christ is going to be unified, it is going to happen with prayer as our foundation. Jesus begins this chapter in John 17. I'm sure you already looked at this, but he begins the chapter by praying for himself. He moves from praying for himself to praying for the disciples, and then he prays for all believers. What an incredible model for our own personal prayer life, that when you start in prayer, you have to pray for yourself, because if you're not good, you can't be good for others. That if I'm not good myself, if I'm not thinking about my own walk with Christ, my own disposition, my own situation as it relates to everything, if I'm not good, I can't be good for others. It starts with praying for myself. And then he prays for those walking alongside him in ministry. And he's really praying, y'all, that God blesses their lives. He's praying that he keeps them protected from the enemy and they stay committed to honoring God. But here it is, our prayer life has to move outside of ourselves. It has to move outside of those we walk alongside. It has to move outside to those we know, from those we see, and extend to all believers. So here it is that our prayer life has to now extend to those in a different tax bracket than us. that it has to extend to those different tax brackets. Here it is. It has to extend to people who don't go to CA. It has to extend up. You got to pray for other people besides those who go to CA. I saw my song leader with CA on that, on his chest. But those who live in a different part of town, it has to extend beyond them. If you're only praying for Southgate, you got it all wrong. That if your only concern are the people who live in your house, you're missing it. The prayer has to extend beyond those that we have relationship with. We have to move outside our comfort zones and show the city, the state, the nation, and even in fact the world, that we as followers of Christ are willing to teach through our actions what unity looks like. We have to. If we're going to model unity, if we're going to live in unity, we have to show the world what it looks like in a tangible and applicable way. Christ's prayer doesn't stop with himself, doesn't stop with the disciples, and doesn't stop just with believers. He includes those who have not believed yet. There it is in verse number 20. The Bible says, John 17 and 20, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. Those who are not believing yet, but they will believe through the word that others share, that the disciples share. And so here it is. If our unity is going to model that of Christ and God the Father, we have to be intentional about reaching to unbelievers. We have to be intentional. See, we cannot sit in our ivory towers and expect for the peasants to come knocking at our door. That we can't have that kind of attitude. We have to have the disposition and the place to say to ourselves that we will reach out to others, that we will humble ourselves. We have to engage the community. We got to be a resource to those in need and exhibit a spirit that welcomes. There is nothing worse than to walk into a place that you've never been before and nobody says hello. Nothing worse than walk into a place that you've never been. I don't know. That didn't happen to me tonight. Several people. I want to take the pressure off. Several people say hello to me. But nothing worse than walk into an unfamiliar place, especially if it's the church and nobody smiles. Nobody exchanges pleasantries. That if it is that we are going to be unified and we're going to reach believers for Christ, we have to have a spirit of welcoming. I say this often. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. That nobody cares if we have the gospel. Nobody cares if you have a message that can change their life if your attitude is not that of hospitality. And so we got to make sure that we are modeling the example of Christ and God the Father. And here it is. Our prayers should be matched with action. An action that shows the importance for those who don't know the Lord. That it has to show up in everything we do. That it has to be important for those who don't know the Lord. We do something at Carmack, and we're very intentional about this, is that when it is that somebody visits for the first time, we put a gift in their hand to make sure they know that we appreciate them coming. Not only do we put a gift in their hand, but if they fill out a card that gives us their address, we send them a handwritten letter to let them know that we appreciate their visit. People have to know that when it is that they walk through that door, that they are appreciated, they are welcome, and it has to show up not just in what we say, and not just Brother Thomas or the elders sharing from the pulpit, but in the pews it shows up as well, that we appreciate and we are engaging to those who may not know the Lord. I shared with you about our efforts as it relates to the homeless, but those physical efforts have to be matched with energy to minister to their souls. So it's not just enough to give them food and shelter and clothing, but we also have to match that same energy that we put towards that to make sure that their souls are fed. So we ask those that we serve, we say, how is it that we can pray for you? How is it we can pray for you? We give them biblical information so they can research for themselves. And here it is. Many of the members of Carmack don't even know this, but the 26th this year, when they check out, is Sunday. And so when they check out on Sunday, we're going to invite them to worship. I know some of y'all squirming in your seats right now. You're just thinking, what? Do what? But I'm saying this, is that oftentimes we like to sit beside people we know. We like to be in comfortable places. But how is it that you, can you reach the lost souls for Christ that maybe live in the streets? That's the challenge now. Now I'm trying to push you in this unity piece because I think that Christ is really speaking to us in a powerful way that if you're going to be unified, you got to be uncomfortable. If you're going to be unified, you got to make sacrifices. If you're going to be unified, it can't be how you always want to be. You have to challenge yourself to be what God would have you to be in order to reach others. And it really takes me into this next space. What are the requirements of unity? What are the requirements of unity? Here it is. Unity requires sacrifice. It requires seeking the need of others. And it requires a willingness to serve. I'm going to say that one more time for the people in the back who can't hear me. Unity requires sacrifice. Unity requires seeking the needs of others. And it requires a willingness to serve. The challenge with walking in unity is we live in a world that celebrates individualism. That's the challenge with unity. The challenge with unity is we live in a world that will fight for the way we want things to be done that suits us. We live in a world that craves personal comfortable. What's personally comfortable for me, we live in a world that craves what's personally comfortable. But unity says it doesn't have to be my way as long as it honors God. That you can sit here and I can sit there, and it doesn't make any difference. I don't have to sit in my favorite seat. I don't have to, you don't have to sing all the verses. You don't have to sing all my favorite songs. You don't have to preach for 30 minutes or 15. If it honors God and it brings souls to Christ, I can adjust. I can take a back seat if it means others will know Christ. Paul says it like this: if eating meat offends my brother, I'm paraphrasing, I can have vegetables and fruit and I'll be okay. That I don't have to have what it is that I always have if it is that means helping somebody else to know Christ. And I'm telling you, the challenge with many of us and the challenge with our churches is that what's stopping us from being more unified, it really is this idea of that we've got too comfortable in the way we want things to be done. And we got to move outside our comfort zones. We got to move outside our places in order to really achieve the unity that God calls us to have. But watch this tenor and tone, you all. Watch the tenor and tone of Christ as he goes to the Father in prayer. I'm still in John 17, but I want to move up to verse number 8 because it's powerful, his tenor and tone, because as I said earlier, that unity requires sacrifice, it requires a willingness to serve, all those things that unity requires, watch what it is that Christ models for us. He says in verse 8, "For I have given to them the words which you've given me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I come forth from you, and that they have believed that you sent me." Watch how it is that Christ pours out his heart. He says to God the Father, "I've given what you gave." It's not about me. It's not about my plans and my agenda. I've given what you gave. I know for sure that I've come from you. That's what Christ says. He says, my goal has been for the disciples to know that it's not about my power. It's not about my ability. It's not about my knowledge. But I am here because you sent me. In John 17, there are so many miracles that Jesus done at this point. You can't even count them. The scripture even tells us that there's many things that are not even recorded in the scripture because there's no way that all could be recorded about what Jesus did and said. And so at this point, he's over and over shared all the things within his power. But he's now in chapter 17 telling them, listen, you know what I did in John chapter 6, where I fed the multitude. You know what I did in John chapter 5, where I healed the man at the pool of Bethesda. All of that was not about me. All of that was because God has sent me on assignment, and I'm really just following his assignment. So there are requirements as it relates to unity, and if we're going to be unified, We got to humble ourselves. But then in verse number 21, John 17 and verse number 21, the Bible says that they all may be one. As you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. That they all may be one as you, that Father, you and I are one, but we want everyone else to be one. That they also may be one in us. That's the idea, that your unity now connects with God the Father in Christ, that the world may believe that you sent me. Here's a point I want you maybe to jot down to remember this, that others will come to believe in Christ through our actions of unity. That others will come to believe in Christ through our actions of unity. It's interesting, John, that I'm teaching through the book of John on Tuesdays. I'm working through the book of John on Tuesday. I'm in John chapter 6 right now. And so through all our online platforms, I teach through that. So I'm working through it. But the point that continues to come up through the book of John is the validity of Christ being the Son of God. That comes up over and over and over. And really, even you see it in verse 21, that the world may believe that the Father sent him. And so I've really been captured by this idea of Jesus really continuing to argue his point about him being the Son of God, and then all the ramifications around that and the challenges that people had. And I'm not going to go way into that because I'd keep you the rest of the night. But it's interesting to me that the whole dialogue and the narrative around that about Jesus being the Son of God. But just for sake of time here, in John 5, the Jews are trying to kill him because he said that he was the Son of God. That's in John chapter 5. So Jesus goes in John 5 through an exercise of who speaks as witnesses to authenticate his identity. And so this is what he says, teenagers. He says that John speaks to who I am. He says that God the Father speaks to who I am. He said the works that I do even speak to who I am. And the scriptures speaks to who I am. And so it's this idea, the reason why Jesus does this is he's speaking to an audience who would understand the idea of witnesses. That they would understand this through the Old Testament, specifically in Deuteronomy. They would understand that law says that no one could be prosecuted, no one could be tried or condemned without the establishment of the word of two or three witnesses. That's just the law. That is what they would understand. And so what Jesus does, and I love the way he does this, is that he doesn't grab two or three witnesses, he grabs four. He gives them four witnesses, four powerful witnesses now. I mean, these are not just your average person walking down the street. He gives them four powerful witnesses to say that these four say that I am the Son of God. So I'm just really intrigued by that. And I'm really challenged by that. And it really has grabbed me. And it brought me to this point that I'm about to leave you with. Could it be that Jesus is trying to teach us that the most effective way for winning souls to him is not an evangelism class? Could he be teaching us that inviting your neighbors to worship is not what he's after completely? Could he be saying that knocking on someone's door is not the answer? But in fact, the greatest tool to winning souls to Christ is demonstrating to the world how we can walk in unity. Maybe, just maybe, I love to interrogate the text. I love to dig in deep and saying to myself, maybe what he's saying, because you see it in verse 21 that he says that I want them to be one and to be connected to us because we're already one, God the Father and the Son. And I want that to happen so that the world may believe that you sent me. So maybe he's saying that when it is that we get it right as it relates to unity and walking in unity, we'll have no problem with the house being filled on a Wednesday night. Maybe if it is that we walk in unity, that maybe we won't work, we'll have so many people, it'll be like Chick-fil-A on a Friday evening, that you have to have all these lanes and lines, that maybe if we get this thing right as it relates to unity, that everything else will fall into place. And maybe, in fact, that Jesus putting this forth and spending so much time in John 17 specifically talking about unity because unity is a big deal. I'm just crazy enough to believe that when Jesus talks about something over and over and over and over again, we probably need to pay attention to it. We probably don't need to gloss over. We probably don't need to just push that to the side. That may be something that we need to really pay attention to and say to ourselves, I got to challenge myself, and you got to challenge yourself, not to be comfortable with what we've always done and the people we've always been with, but challenge ourselves to really work hard at unity. And I'm telling you, it's not easy. It's not easy to move outside your comfort zone. It's not easy to engage with people that you really don't know. It's not easy to really welcome when you don't know if you're going to receive a welcome back. But I just think this is that if we trust God, that if we have mustard seed faith, just mustard seed faith, that will now we say to ourselves that, God, I'm just going to trust you at your word. And if you say that if I exercise unity, that people are going to be drawn to you, that people are going to want to know you, that people are going to see the example that we model, and they're going to say to themselves, how in the world can this society be so messed up, but the church gets it right? How can there be Democrats and Republicans and rich and poor and this side and that side, everywhere else, but the church is a melting pot of all different tax brackets, of all different ethnicities and all different backgrounds and all different upbringings, this side of the track, that side of the track. I believe that that's what he's after, that he's trying to push us towards the place to where we are unified, to the place to where all the things that divide us are mean nothing to us. That's it doesn't matter anything about where you grew up. It doesn't matter what your background is. It doesn't matter what your lean is. It doesn't make a difference, because if we are unified on the fact that Jesus Christ died for our sins, we're unified that he rose on the third day, that we're unified that he conquered both death, hell, and the grave, he's given us an opportunity to receive salvation. And that's what I want to extend to you on this evening, that there may be some that need prayer on this evening. We've already heard the prayer request, and I tell folks at Carmack all the time that take those prayer requests with you. There's a reason why somebody's sharing that with you. They trust you that you're going to take it to the Father on their behalf. And so I encourage you to pray for those who have asked for prayer, but also if you are in need of prayer, please share that on today. Please share your prayer requests, because you're not alone. I said on my Tuesday Bible study, this is Mental Health Awareness Week. October 3rd through the 9th is Mental Health Awareness Week, and mental health is a serious situation. My son lost one of his friends that was 17 years old to suicide earlier this week. And here it is that mental health affects us all, young and old and everywhere in between. But I want you to understand that there's power in prayer, as I said earlier, that whatever you're dealing with, that God can meet you at your area of need. That whatever it is that seems so big and so overwhelming and so like I can't handle it, I promise you, if you take it to God in prayer, that he can handle it. That he can give you peace, that he can give you a calm, that he can ease your anxieties. So if there's anybody in here that's dealing with something that seems overwhelming, just too much, ask for prayer. I'm a living witness that I'm telling you that God answers prayer. So I ask you to take God on and to try him and ask for prayer. For those who have not made a commitment to Christ through baptism, we offer that opportunity to you as well. To decide tonight that, you know what, that I'm saying goodbye to my old life and I want to say hello to a new life. That happens when it is that you realize that Christ gave his life in order for you to have life. He did it on the cross of Calvary. As I was in the Middle East in Jerusalem, there's a place where they've marked that, where they laid the body of Jesus, and And the amazing thing is that it's not there. There's just the remnants and a lot of stuff around it. The reason why it's not there is because he was resurrected bodily. That's never happened before, and it never will happen again, but he was resurrected bodily in order to show us that the same way that he was risen from the dead, that we can be risen from our dead state. That's where we are. If we're not in relationship with Christ, we're in a dead state. And so I encourage you to be risen from your dead state, believing that he did that act of giving his life for us, repenting of your sins, confessing on tonight that he is the Son of God, then be willing to be baptized. We say this often, that the water is always ready. That we just believe that when you're ready, the angels are ready, we're ready to celebrate, and we'll baptize you on tonight if that is your desire. And so we invite you to give your life to Christ. We invite you to ask for prayer. Whatever you need, do that as we together stand and sing.